Good afternoon, everybody. Our next talk is going to be about how to make a biolab for less than 500 euros. I'm pretty curious. And nowadays, we're all walking around with heart rate monitors, with patches, with things on our head. And sometimes they look very complex. And what a speaker would like to show you is that you can make them. And they're less complicated as it might seem. Still a bit challenging, but less complicated than it might seem. Our next speaker, Pieter from Boheemen, leads the fablab at the Waag Society. It's a prestigious research institute in Leiden, and he has a background in biotechnology from the TU Delft. And he's experimented a lot and found ways of putting together biotechnology in a cheap and reliable way. So please welcome on the stage Pieter Boheemen to tell you all about it.
Thank you. Thank you. All right, yes, welcome everyone. I'm delighted to be here, of course, and to introduce you into the field of do-it-yourself biology, often also called biohacking. My background is really in biotechnology. I've been trained in a place like this. Does it look any familiar to anybody of you? Yeah, you work in a lab like this, okay. Yeah, what I always thought when I was in these places is that, you know, it looks very high-tech, but in reality, the innovation that takes place with the machines there is somewhat similar to what happened to the fax machine. You know, those machines were developed, they were introduced, just like the fax machine, let's say, in the 80s. They were cumbersome to operate, they were loud, frustrating, and, well, just like with the fax machine, it always stayed the same. Nothing changed. Well, I have tried to change that. I work at the Waag Society in Amsterdam, really, not in Leiden. and we have a research institute in this building, the Waag. You might know it if you visit Amsterdam. It is a lot of people think it's just a restaurant, but actually on the first and the second floor, there is a fab lab, there's a wet lab, there's actually a textile lab, there's a lot of action going on. And in the fab lab, you can make things yourself. It's a digital fabrication laboratory. That's what it stands for, fablab. And that means that there are 3D printers, there are laser cutters, there are vinyl cutters, automated milling machines, all kinds of machines that can make other machines. And the place is crowded with hackers. And hackers, those are people that like to create stuff, people that are curious, that work in a, let's say, duocracy way, so they value action over talking. They have a slight distaste of authority, so I always try to go into new directions and see what the boundaries are, and they apply a certain playful cleverness to their work. And if you take those hackers and introduce them into the world of biology, very interesting things happen. First of all, this world of biology, I don't know if you're all familiar with that, but people who are in the field of biotech, just like me, we believe that the 21st century is going to be the century of biology, because we're now able to engineer ecosystems, we're able to engineer our food, medicine, and maybe even our body. And the previous speaker here spoke about that, about superpowers. So maybe one day in this century we'll look like this, who knows. Engineers are creating the tools for that. So for example, on the top left you see a DNA printer, on the right organ printers, maybe even artificial wombs, who knows, and technology is getting smaller and smaller and smaller. And this is quite fascinating because the technology also becomes accessible. If you see where the whole biotech scene came from, and we've come a long way since, for example, the discovery of DNA in the 50s, it's now moving towards a field where, well, it's more getting like a kit. We have standardized DNA parts. We have starting to have machines that can do the laboratory work for us. And it's starting to become more abstract. So doing your own biology experiments becomes more or less child play. You can assemble experiments and try them out. And this led to the rise of a new movement. Since 2008, there's a group online that call themselves do-it-yourself biologists. And those are people who promote the belief that anybody can do biology, and that the tools are getting cheaper and more accessible. For example, there's a network of people called Hackteria, and they try to reappropriate, let's say, ordinary devices into laboratory devices. So you see, for example, here on the top left, a laser tweezer. So that's a device with which you can capture living cells with a laser made out of a DVD drive. And on the right, you see an example of how to turn a webcam into a microscope by flipping the lens. Those kind of people got together more and more often throughout a couple of years, and that led to the foundation of community biolabs. And those are places where people basically can become a member. And by paying a contribution, they have a shared lab, and they can experiment with what they want. And such a place is also what we have in our lab in Amsterdam. And others take a different route. They set up their own lab. For example, Cahal, this was already in 2012, set up his own bio lab in his bedroom. And he managed to get also a GMO license for this. So he was the first individual in Europe to have his own genetic engineering license, so he could do that work at home. And you can see already this lab looks a lot less complicated and, let's say, sterile than a typical biology lab. There's a self-made PCR machine over here, and a pressure cooker for doing sterilizing materials, and this has some chemicals, and that's basically all you need to do genetic engineering. So at De Waag, we started also around that time a group of so-called do-it-yourself biologists, and we get together every week on Tuesday evenings, and we start to experiment. We did a lot of different workshops, going from growing paper and ink to trying to make electricity with microbes, fuel cells, trying to make superfoods, even dissections, brain hacking. All these things got together, and this created some also projects. So, for example, a project that we worked on was trying to make artificial, or actually natural, but ivory not from an elephant, but trying to make it in the lab to try to grow it. Turns out you can make very small particles already with cell cultures. And a designer called Nina van den Broek, she turned it into a jewelry. So you can actually get ivory-ish materials. We experiment with all the types of materials, trying to print biological tissues, scaffolds for tissues. For example, this is agar that we print in three-dimensional shapes. We also do, let's say, more explorations of ethical boundaries. Like this was at the Lowlands Festival, where there was a setup where you could micro-inject zebrafish embryos with algae, trying to make a human plant or an animal plant hybrid. And you can do that also yourself. And we also organize hackathons like Hack the Brain, where we spent the whole weekend on trying to link computers to the mind and explore what we can do with that. And actually, the 24th and 26th of June, there will be a new Hack the Brain hackathon. And we also have a GMO license. So in our lab, you can try to edit DNA. You can give it a try. Make, for example, glowing bacteria or something more spectacular. That's up to you. So there's a lot of possibilities that you can do with biology. And maybe you think like, I want this, and I want this at home, or in my garage, or in a place where I can decide for myself what I want to do. Well, I think you can do that for less than 500 euros, so you can make your own bio kit yourself. All you need is, I think, a fablab, or a makerspace, or a hackspace close to you, where they have the basic machines that you need to make other machines, like a laser cutter and a 3D printer. And you need some skills in electronics to assemble everything. But if you look through this kit, it contains more or less everything that you would normally expect in a typical bio lab. So you have a sterile hood, a thermocycler, spectrometer, a centrifuge kit, some pumps for controlling bioreactors. Of course, you need an incubator to grow stuff. And let's take a closer look at these devices and how they're built. So, for example, the sterile hood. That's a kind of a fundamental unit that you always work with in a bio lab. You need a place in which you can work sterile. So that means you have your sample with your culture of algae, of bacteria that you're very careful about. You want to protect that from other living things like fungus. You can do that by having a cabinet in which the air is filtered. So what happens in these sterile hoods, these are some typical examples in industry, is that air is pumped through a filter by a fan. So air goes from left to right, and there's a fan that sucks it through a pre-filter, blows it through a so-called HEPA filter. And you're in luck, because these HEPA filters are sold as office air purifying filters for only like 30 euros. So a company like Fellows, they sell them. And those are actually class 14 filters, so they are available everywhere. You can order them online. And for a blower, you can just go to IKEA. And for 25 euros, you get a 250 cubic meter per hour blower. It's actually cheaper than trying to buy the blower itself. You get the cabinet with it and the whole device. But if you just take that apart, and we published online the sketches for making such a device. Yeah, you can put your filter in a box and the blower behind it, and it works works great. Then you have your first sterile hood. The next, the incubator. So you need an incubator to grow microbes or fungi at a stable temperature. Well, typically, incubators look like this. They kind of look like a fridge, but they don't cool things, but actually keep a stable temperature. Some of them have shakers. They always, it's basically a box with a heating element in it. It's not so complicated. So if you want to build it yourself, what you need is a little microcomputer, so an Arduino, and some heating element. So what we did here, took a little heating foil and a fan and a sensor. And well, you can even take that separately and put it into a box. We kind of overdone it here. We actually made the box ourselves. Well, if you build it, make it yourself, I would recommend just to take a box that already exists and put the microcontroller in there. But this also works fine. You can control the temperature between, say, room temperature and up to like 60 degrees. But often you only need 25 or 37 for biology. So that works. Then another example of trying to be a little bit more clever is, of course, you need stirrers to mix liquids in which microbes are growing. You can, of course, buy one. I think a typical stirrer costs about 250 euros or even more. I've seen them up to 400 euros for a laboratory-grade stirrer. Well, if you look into the patents, and that's the only great thing about patents is that they're open, so you can look how they're made. You can see it doesn't really, it's not really so complex. You can, what we did is we took a fan and glue a little magnet to the blade. You put it in a box, and there you go. You have a magnetic stirrer. That's all it needs. So this one, you can build it for like 10 euros instead of 400. Then, okay, getting a little bit more complex because the other devices are quite simple. PCR machine, also often called a DNA copying machine. Typical machine costs about 5,000, maybe 10,000 euros. Of course, they have some nice features, gradient PCR, or you can store a lot of programs inside. But really, what it is an Arduino-controlled toaster. You have a heating element and the microcomputer that heats it up and cools it down according to a certain temperature. And I don't really see why you would pay 5 or 10,000 euros for that. And there are a lot of biohackers who feel the same. So I think the PCR machine has been the most hacked and copied machine that's out there. There are so many examples online if you look for it. Because you only need some kind of heating source, a temperature, and a controller. And even children do that nowadays. I saw this article in the Daily Mail where two boys made their own PCR machine in their garage. And you can use it, for example, when there was this horse meat scandal in the news. It was about, I think, 1 year ago with the horse meat in a lasagna. People came to our lab and said, oh, can we test that ourselves? Can we see what kind of meat is in our lasagna? We said, okay, sure. We have this PCR machine that we made ourselves. We can also make the gel box. You can make all these things yourself. And let's extract the DNA, run the protocol. And well, if you're familiar with molecular biology, you always get these nice bands on the gel. And based on that, you can say whether it's a horse or cow or pig meat. So that's doable too. Then let's get to the more dangerous or tricky devices. So centrifuges. Who works with centrifuges regularly? You do? Yeah? You do work with them? Yeah? And are you always comfortable using them? But sometimes maybe... Is that... Sorry? A blender? Or, okay. Well, it's difficult to hear you, but well, maybe in the, during the questions we can get back to it. Well, the tricky thing with centrifuges always is, of course, they move really fast. And things that are moving fast can be a bit scary. So, yeah, the typical centrifuges of industry, they are often with heavy machines, with a rotor in there with a room for like 20 samples, and you can control the time and the speed at which it's spinning. And some of them are even cooled. They have a cooling element in the back, so you can keep your samples at a constant temperature. Well, hackers have tried also many different attempts to make one yourself. So the easiest one is to just make a little rotor and attach it to a drill. And I wouldn't really recommend this, but I've seen it work. So you put the thing on a Dremel or a drill and then point it in the other direction and spin it. don't look, you know, that the tubes are not falling out of the rotor. Some other clever guys basically put the Dremel inside of a box. That's already, I'd say, a better idea. You can also use a hard drive. Most hard drives, they spin at 7,400 RPM. So, if you put your sample on there, that also works. But I kind of got inspired by this one. This is a centrifuge that I made myself. On the inside, there is a rotor from a drone, from a helicopter drone. And as you may know, most helicopter drones, the rotors, they spin at about 10,000 RPM. Well, that is also the same speed that you would use in a bio lab. When testing it, I would recommend not putting the rotor on there yet, because maybe it starts flying if you didn't design your box right. But you can certainly do this. And also, on the side, I taped some white tape and black tape and put an infrared sensor next to it, so you can actually count the RPMs based on the color of the rotor. And you have to use good, strong tape, otherwise the tape spins off the rotor. So that's a piece of advice. All the designs, of course, of all these devices are online, including the wiring scheme so that you can connect all the pieces. And for example, for this centrifuge, also the rotor is completely open design. So this enables anybody to change the design or improve it, or maybe adapt it to your use. Maybe you want to have 24 holes instead of 8, or you can do that yourself with open source tools. And what I really like is when I go somewhere and see these devices in the wild. So I've been publishing open source designs for, I think, the last 2 or 3 years. And every now and then I walk into a hackerspace or another place, and then, hey, somebody made the Stera hood, or, the stirrer made out of plastic instead of out of wood. So it's also cool, I think, to share your designs and see how others adopt it and change it. Also, the centrifuge you see over here, I like the Ferrari red one. It looks more dangerous. And from this you can also see that people can come to the same solution from different directions. So that's also pretty cool. If you don't really know where to start with this, and you would still like to do it, then we also have a program at the WAAG. It's called Biohack Academy. And it's a 10-week course in which we teach you how to do all this and how to start your own biology lab, how to work with microbes, with fungi, with algae, turn this into a project of your own, and really to build a lab and not just use it, but also share it. And this sharing part, of course, is very important, because what I said in the beginning, hackers, they create things and they want to share things, because that's not just to show off what you are capable of, but also it's a strategy. So by putting your designs out there in the open, you basically force others to do that as well, because now that there are really good open source designs, there's no point anymore in buying a closed source device. So it's basically you break open a market. And this course, we teach it about once a year. The next one will start again in January next year. And it's also a distributed course. So we test this open source character straight away, put it into practice. So in the first edition, we worked together with a group in Sao Paulo and also in Rio de Janeiro, in Barcelona and in Rome. And you can also see already that people, you send them the design, but then they say, well, we don't really like the setup, so we're going to change it. So everybody adjusts the laboratory tools to their own needs. And that's something you cannot do with any devices that you buy off the shelf. Also, in the second edition, we worked together with a group in Iran, in Tehran, helped them to build up a lab. And then they also run into trouble with trying to source the materials, because not everything is available over there. So before that, I didn't think it would be possible, but they actually showed me how you can make a rotor by drilling it out of wood, even though I would say it's quite complex to drill all the holes at the right angle. But they made the first completely fully wooden laboratory centrifuge device, which I was quite impressed by. And also, a nicer incubator with a side screen so you can look into the plates while the microbes are growing. Also a clever innovation. And of course, you know, these type of activities are a lot of fun. You know, we spent a lot of time in the lab trying to figure things out together and learning from each other. So that's also very cool to do. And you see that also other people start to pick it up. So for example, in Sao Paulo, there are now schools using these devices, and that this was a recording by the national television in Brazil. So they started to promote these open source devices throughout the country. So every Tuesday we are open, our lab. You can come by. This is how it looks like on the inside when we clean everything up a little bit. Normally, especially after Christian has been in the lab, it can be quite messy. But when we clean up, it looks like this. We have microscopes. We have standard incubators, of course, but also the PCR machine. The printer at the moment is not there anymore, but we can make one again. We have plenty of 3D printers, and if you put a syringe on it, you can print liquids. You're welcome to drop by. We work with a lot of people, of course. I'm not doing this on my own. This is the make group within the Waag Society. People are all working in the fablab and the wet lab. And we would really like to give you a bit of a feeling of a taste of what it's like to do this yourself. So we'll have a challenge for you. That will actually start at 4 o'clock, and it started first with trying to make microscopes, but later it evolved into something completely different, or actually I think better. Christian and Roland, who are sitting over here, and together with the help of Ingmar, have tried to develop a biotic gaming setup. And Ingmar has already presented it. I don't know if you all seen it on the main stage. It's a way in which you can, it's a device in which you can control the movement of microbes, or small organisms, and apply a virtual gaming layer over that. So you can really interact with these microbes. And we made kits for you to really make those microscopes, and also prepare software and things you can hack to make your own games. And we'll do that at 4 o'clock in that area over there. So yeah, please join us there. And thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Pieter, for the talk. And I learned something, that it's in Amsterdam and not in Leiden. I'm taking some questions. Questions.
Oh, so very nice. I have a question about the safety. Is there safety standards? We already talked about the centrifuge. If someone else makes another version of it, should there be, I don't know, some testing with it in a label of saying it is safety approved, you can do it or you're not? Are you afraid of people hurting themselves if someone makes it?
Yeah, of course, I'm concerned with that. So when you go into the source code of the centrifuge, you'll notice that everywhere I wrote down at the beginning, be careful, this is dangerous. This is a dangerous machine. If you don't know what you're doing, you can lose an eye or maybe worse. But at the same time, I also trust in the people who are, who think they are capable of doing this, that they read the instructions well, and also that if they find something to improve, that they would contribute it to the to the comments and to the design, because it's all open. You can easily, you can just write down in the system, hey, I tried this, it failed, or maybe the screws start to detach after 10 rounds, or there's a lot of things that could go wrong, indeed. But it's, I think it's a shared responsibility. It's by being in doing it in an open way, yeah, everybody can contribute to this to the safety of the devices.
Other questions? Yeah.
Well, two questions actually. First, who is mostly joining your lab? Is it the biology people or technology people? And your academies, do you need some kind of background to join in on them?
Yeah, those are good questions. Yeah, so we have open evenings, we have like workshops that we organize, and really academies, so that's a kind of a gradient of different type of activities. Most of the people who join, they are keen, they like technology, but they're not necessarily biologists. Actually, I think most of them are not. Many of the people who come are designers and artists, actually, to our lab. So they want to get a feel for this technology, what it's like, what can you do with it, explore the possibilities. There are actually too little, I would say too few biologists that come to the evening. It would be better if more of them would join us. And when I look, for example, at the academies, people who signed up, some of them are retired and interested in longevity and trying to extend their lives. Others are futurists, others are entrepreneurs, architects, designers. Some of them are really engineers, so they really want to build stuff and get their hands on the technology, but it's difficult to stereotype it. It's
Everybody walk in. And
yeah, it's really open. It's also on Tuesday evenings for free. So, it's really a wide diversity of people. Yeah, and also I think about half of them are women, male, men. It's about equal, so it's not really targeted towards one of them. No.
And how? What is the learning curve of your workshop, of your joint workshop?
We assume that that everybody has a very little background in what we're going to do. So we start at a basic level. We have instruction videos. There are, of course, we have instructions ourselves, demonstrations. So you can really join the workshop if you have no background in whatsoever in what I just spoke about. Maybe even better, because then we can test whether we prepared ourselves well. And of course, it's useful if you have some experience with coding or optics, or it's not necessary. Yeah.
Yeah. And it takes an hour to build a webcam microscope.
I've seen, especially children do it really fast. Most children do it like in 15 minutes.
A webcam microscope.
Yeah. And with adults, it often takes a half an hour to an hour.
Okay, most of my questions have already been answered, like background, learning curve. Also, how much does it cost to join your the academy, the course?
Yeah, so the academy is a 10-week program, and 2 days a week you're in the lab. And for students, it's 200 euros. And if you're not a student, then it's more expensive than 1,000 euros. So it's, yeah.
I probably really shouldn't ask this, but how bad of an idea is it to make these things out of cardboard, out of carton?
Yeah, so cardboard and water are not really a good combination. And in biology labs, we often work with liquids. So that's a tricky thing. But when you're prototyping, then cardboard is perfect material. And then it's a cheap material. You can quickly test whether things fit, whether it makes sense, whether you can still put your fingers where they have to be. you can really test things quickly. Then MDF is, I think, nice for having a kind of functional prototype. But still, MDF and water, also not a very good combination. So once you've settled down, it's good to make it out of some kind of plastic or finish it with a coating.
One last question? No? Yes.
How and why did you start it to do biohacking, and how would you describe the biohacking community worldwide?
Those are two good questions. Personally, how I started, well, I was trained as a biotechnologist. I started in Delft, but then after that, I worked in IT for a while. So because I had my own IT company, and I was working at a consulting company, Accenture, and I felt I still wanted to do biology, so I started to do it at home and build my own lab a little bit, and then discovered that other people were doing that as well. So online, you can find discussion groups and websites. So that's how I kind of rolled into it and organized events for it. And the whole movement, or let's say the whole scene around the world, it's a very interconnected group of people because everybody's on social networks. Most of them are a bit also activistic. They want to change the system that's out there. They want to change science, or they want to change the way innovations are done, or want to create their own medicine, or want to create useful tools for themselves. And they are kind of frustrated that it's not being offered by industry or as a product. So they start making it themselves. That's often the motivation that you see. And people get together quite often. So when you go online, you can find announcements for events every now and then in the world, and meet up with people. And then that's where people exchange their skills and their tools. So it's a very open community.
Yeah. Thank you very much. We have a gift for you. Ah. From the organization.
Oh, cool.
It's what a do-it-yourself tent.
Do-it-yourself tent. Okay, great.
Please like give that. A big applause for Pieter. And hope to see you all at 4 p.m. in the room next door. So we're going to build a webcam microscope. Thank you very much.
Thank you.